Yeah. A lot of people ask me, well, not a lot of people. I have been asked in the past, like, how I got into anti-fascism or, you know, that kind of thing. And the short-term answer is, like, I was a part of the Earth First Journal collective, and then some fascists started talking about Earth First, saying that they had basically joined the movement and were, like, helping out. And so we had to figure out exactly what was going on there. Of course, they hadn't. They weren't involved at all, and they were trying to appropriate the entire thing and make themselves also appear more green and stuff like that. And so we had to publicize that this is utter nonsense and really dig into the roots of who these people were. They're national anarchists, one of these kinds of fascist groups that would try to slip under the radar by using the idea of anarchism, using left-wing ideas to gain some sort of credibility for extreme authoritarianism and racism and general hatred of equality. So that was not even that long ago, and AK Press approached me and they were like, "Do you want to write a book about this?" And at first I said, I might know some other people who should do that. So I approached a couple of other people, and, you know, they were either having their own projects that they were doing or not really, you know, interested in it. And so I just said, all right, fine, I'll do this book. So that's what this turned into, Against the Fascist Creep. I was reluctant for a lot of reasons. You know, I don't think of myself as, like, an intellectual leader of anti-fascism whatsoever. Although, you know, in my own life, my own life has been completely, you know, I've been relatively lucky because my parents were total anti-fascists. My dad was rescued from Birmingham during the Blitz bombing campaign that the Nazis were doing, and spent the early part of his life in Wales, in a rural countryside in Wales. My mom's dad fought in World War II, and my grandma's Jewish. So a lot of that contributed to me growing up as an anti-fascist, although I'm from Houston, Texas, so starting an ARA chapter when I was in high school didn't seem like that smart of a thing. ARA, Anti-Racist Action, you know, but I just tried to do kind of like that swing kids type stuff, cultural praxis to try and prevent the rise of fascist ideas, not just on the right, but also to undermine authoritarianism, elitism, and the sorts of things that contribute to fascist, what Sarah Ahmed calls the affective economy. So the sort of emotional groundwork that provides a basis for political organization. So that's one thing that I wanted to touch on, especially, is that fascism doesn't come out of happy communities who are providing for one another, although that is like a propaganda that fascism puts forward, that in the future, you know, we'll have these extreme, happy, productive people. In fact, fascism comes out of deep feelings of alienation, anxiety, and it exploits depression. So in Germany, there would never have been a popular Nazi party without the Great Depression, in fact, and without people's disaffection with the left, especially the Social Democratic Party, which joined hands with the paramilitary Freikorps to attack, assassinate, and put down the rebel leaders of the left throughout the 1920s. So that's a significant issue, is that fascism comes about through despair and disillusionment with the left's answers to that despair. In some cases, it can be a kind of a nihilism, in the Nietzschean sense, in the sense of a positive or active nihilism, that we have to destroy everything in order to start anew, right? And that's what scholars call the palingenetic side of fascism, that rebirth of an ancient sort of mythic past that has to be rescued from the ashes of especially liberal democracy, the corrupt bureaucracies, and rise like a phoenix through some sort of spiritual engagement with eternal mythos, right? That's how fascism develops its theoretical and ideological edifice. So some people might say it's kind of woo. It's kind of new agey in some ways. There are a lot of ideas, especially through the Nazi movement, of subcultural sort of occultism, reaching into these weird theories of root races, that humanity actually came from Hyperborea in the Arctic as like 8 feet tall, grand, you know, perfect white people who then traveled south and gradually became Lemurians and sort of like devolved into what is now the human race. And we have to go back to the ancient archetypes of India and the Himalayas and Tibet, Nepal, to really find the spiritual essence of our great Hyperborean ancestors from the Arctic. And those kinds of things would reoccur. So obviously, you know, you find it's not unusual to find fascists who like to meditate, who are very, you know, into Eastern religions. You know, that's why the Nazis appropriated the swastika. So, and after the World War II, you find this kind of connection emerging underneath the political radar with people like Julius Evola, who people still think of today as, well, maybe he wasn't completely fascist, maybe he was, oh, he's just an occultist, he's just an elitist or a traditionalist, or all of these sort of like cryptic words that disguise a tremendous amount of engagement with fascist politics and extreme ultra-violence. So we'll talk about that a little bit. I know it's not quite the cheery subject that you all expected this evening. What else? What do people want to hear about in terms of the fascist creep? I mean, I want to read a bit from the book to introduce fascism and the definition of fascism. Talk about Evola and maybe some of the alt-right, Trump. Right? Mm-hmm. All right. So, without further ado, I'll try to read for y'all. It's been a long day. My bike tire has a flat in it, so if I skip a word or two, give me a break. And thank y'all for being here. give me a couple of breaks. All right. Thank y'all for being here. It means a lot to me. And, So the bookstore ran out of books. They're using mine. Whatever I make from those books, I'm gonna. And this is a total thing. Is that all the royalties from the book are gonna be split, and I'm gonna donate half of them to anti-fascist and feminist groups doing good work. So, hey, thanks. So yeah. Feel free to buy a book because it goes to a good cause, local bookstores, and keeping up the good fight. So, I'm going to just read from the beginning, right? Okay. it's Andy Kaufman here. In the years before Nazi invasion, as fascism pulled activists from the ranks of the left, Popular Front leader Léon Blum spoke of a contagion gripping France. Some 50 years later, scholar Philippe Burin would refer to the fascist drift that attracted the left to the causes of the right. More recently, warnings of a creeping fascism have returned. I don't know who's doing that, but If we consider the left's embrace of equality as its defining characteristic, fascism remains decisively on the right. However, fascism also embraces aspects of social and ecological movements usually attributed to the left. The shared ideological space cannot be tidally blamed on co-optation, although many fascists embrace co-optation and entryism. Instead, fascism emerges as a unique response to the same material conditions. It lies at the extremes of ideology, courting the public through a rejection of conventional conservatism and a call for the return of a golden era. Against the Fascist Creep will focus on these messy crossovers on the margins of left and right, the ways fascism cultivates a movement, and the ways that the left often unwittingly cedes the space for fascism to creep into the mainstream and radical subcultures. So the analysis of fascism, if you actually take a long-range view of it, at the time when fascism was emerging, there wasn't a tremendous amount of analysis from the left on what fascism actually meant. Malatesta has an interesting piece where he recounts this experience he had walking down the street, where he finds this sort of petit bourgeois guy who he kind of knew a little bit. Maybe they were sort of acquainted, but they weren't good friends. They didn't necessarily share the same exact class interests or political ideas, but this guy was walking down the street with a fascist badge and stopped Malatesta, and you know, he said, "How are you doing?" And Malatesta says, "Why are you a fascist now?" And the guy's like, "Well, you know, it gives me power, it's strength, and we need to get the country back together and actually have the force and vitality of the nation again." So the principle of fascism was this empowerment, especially that the small business owners felt as well. There were a lot of intellectuals and sort of lawyers, but it wasn't a workers' movement as much as it tried to be. Mussolini himself came from the radical left. It's said that his father actually participated in one of the branches of the Internationale in Bologna called Fascio Operaio, which, if you know, like Italian 19th century Italian history, Fascio didn't mean like the emperor's, you know, bundle of lictors that symbolized the patriarchal famulae coming together to form the monarchy of ancient Rome. It actually just meant league, or group of people committed to the same cause. There was a fasci movement in Sicily of peasants rising up against landlords, and they would actually use monarchist and papal slogans while they fought for the rights of the peasants. So the 19th century fascism is not what we think of as fascism. It's kind of a generic sort of populist thing. However, Mussolini comes out of the left. He even chastises anarchists like Carlo Tresca for being not revolutionary enough. And he makes friends with Leda Raffanelli, or at least tries to. He wants to develop a peasant movement by doing exactly what Lenin did, which is sort of discerning a middle peasantry and using them to overcome the sort of landed elite, or pretending to, you know, claiming he would do that. So the lower class of landless peasants would join in the movement, and he would gain more power. And this was his, while the national syndicalists were working within the cities to unite nationalism and futurism and syndicalism, Mussolini was more of a sort of organizer of peasants, or at least he wanted to be. And then he rose to become, more through his charisma than his actual intellect, the editor of Avanti, which was the primary organ of the Socialist Party at the time. So absolutely, Mussolini is on the left. And then comes the first shock, which is the Italian invasion of Libya, where socialists actually jump on this bandwagon, or remain equivocal, about whether or not Italy should colonize Libya. You know, and then you get Marinetti saying that the bombing campaign is like as beautiful as sterilization or something like that. and Marinetti being published in the same journals as radical anarchists and nationalists and syndicalists that are being overseen by the famous syndicalist from France, Georges Sorel, who's still to this day considered the sort of advocate of the general strike and the mythical workers' rebellion, although he himself combined far right and left from France to Italy. So fascism emerged from both of these things together, from Mussolini's sort of charismatic personality and ability to rise to the top, and from this brewing of discontent between left and right, wanting to overthrow the sort of, they thought, lazy, bureaucratic, functionalist, ineffectual, liberal democratic system of parliamentarianism. They also incorporated a lot of elements from the sort of rebellious anarchist movement, the sort of anti-papism at the beginning of it, the desire for a sort of aesthetic revolution, an anti-party, Mussolini called it, a movement that had vigor and vitality instead of platforms and boring congresses and things like that. So in a way, and as Mussolini would say before his march on Rome, which brought him into power basically, the anarchists went halfway to what he wanted to put into power. The anarchists developed the myth of a sort of anti-state state, and he only had to put it one way further in order to establish authority, order, and all those things that make fascists really excited. The real breaking point there was World War I. After Libya, World War I happened. Italy was uncertain at first, and then members of the left decided to join with the nationalists and rattle their sabers and say, let's get involved in this war. Mussolini was one of them. The Socialist Party expelled him. So he never rebuked socialism. He was expelled from the Socialist Party, and up to that point, he had been a major leader. So at that point, fascism starts to coalesce, and then after World War I, he starts saying, there's a trenchocracy now. The people who fought in the trenches of World War I are now in the foreground of political revolution and should be leading the way, clearing out the old bourgeoisie and the old administrative bureaucracy, and emerging at the forefront, the new man. Right? This is what it was identified as, the new man, with all the technology and the machismo and so on. So with Germany, there's a totally different story happening. But Germany lost World War I. So Germany emerged from World War I humiliated because it was, World War I. So because it was an industrial power, it thought itself the leader of Europe. It had beaten Austria, it had beaten France in war. They still thought that Bismarck was their legacy. And they lost, and they were humiliated. So the state that emerged there had a socialist edifice that worked as well with the paramilitary Freikorps and the far right to destroy the radical left. And it was out of that paramilitary movement that, interestingly enough, they called the patriotic movement, that that fascism emerged. It fused again workerism and militarism, colonialism, patriarchal misogyny, and ultra-violence. So that was the culture of German fascism. Not unlike Italian fascism, and the two were not necessarily friends. So you read the book and there's more about the conflicts that emerged between the different fascisms that came about, how they undermined one another and eventually contributed to the complete downfall of fascism, the demise of fascism, and but not before terrible violence and genocide of 6 million Jews and so many others in the Holocaust and the attack on the Soviet Union and elsewhere. So fascism is gone, right? After World War II, there's denazification and fascism is gone. Nobody has to worry about fascism anymore.
Yeah.
America's number one. We did it,
yeah,
right? Everybody should be thankful because the United States came in and won. Okay, so part of that's true, right? The United States, several hundred thousand people were killed fighting against fascism and imperialism, that's what they say. However, there were still many fascists in positions of significant industrial power in the United States. DuPont, Ford, the Morgan banks, they were all fascist when Italy was fascist in its prime. They all supported the American Legion, which called itself the American Fascisti. And the American Legion jumped into bed with the Klan, with the strikebreakers in Detroit, and GM was helping them out, right? So GM and Ford, in fact, provided most of the troop transport vehicles for the Wehrmacht. It's pretty startling before the war. So, and in Italy, the famous denazification process was actually the opposite. They actually recruited members of Mussolini's government into the security state in Italy and enlisted them with fascist terrorist organizations to engage in what was called the strategy of tension. Have you all ever heard of the strategy of tension? Yeah. Okay, so the strategy of tension was devised sort of by this guy named Giulio Evola, who I'll read a little bit about. A very creepy, creepy dude, a big occultist, who said at first that the state generally is a populist and altogether too earthly and boring thing that should be destroyed. However, after World War II, the issue of order within society, political society in Europe, was such that fascists should actually reinforce the state. And through the strategy of tension, fascists would bomb infrastructure sites, assassinate leaders of the left, blame the left, and draw the public towards the state. So that was actually, and if y'all think I'm crazy, you can actually look at the Prime Minister of Italy.
Aldo Moro, was that the one?
No, Andreotti, oh, okay. In 1990, because he went in front of Parliament and admitted the whole thing. He's also known as the Divine Giulio, because he's untouchable. This is the time when Aldo Moro was kidnapped.
Yeah. Right.
And assassinated, and his body was left halfway between the trade union headquarters and the Communist Party headquarters. And it was supposedly an action by the left to send a message, right? To send a message to the public and say, we don't care about your compromises, we don't care about being involved in parliament, we want a revolution, right? Mm-hmm. But then, as I show in the book, if you read more about Renato Curcio, who was the one of the founders and the leaders of the Red Brigades that carried out this attack, he made his way to the left through a fascist organization.
Yeah.
I'll just read a little bit about Giulio Evola so y'all can get a sense of the creepiness. All right. So. Perhaps the most influential of these elite spiritualists remaining after the war was Julius Evola. His followers were unique in that they wanted more than populism could offer. They wanted blood, sacrifice, and ultra-violence. They believed in and became a formidable cult of assassins and bombers bent on infiltrating the left and destroying its public reputation by heightening tensions and causing ever grander spectacles of destruction and terror. According to the figurehead of the fascist Movimento Sociale Italiano, at the MSI, Giorgio Almirante, Evola could be compared to important leftist intellectuals and theorists. He was our Marcuse, only better. Evola had asserted as early as 1930 in his political review La Torre, "We would like a more radical fascism, more fearless, a really absolute fascism made of pure force, impervious to any compromise." Now he hoped to put that potential into action without Mussolini's bungling in the way. This fascism would renounce the tendency to base political power on a mass movement, emphasizing instead an elite of warrior aristocrats gaining spiritual power over Europe. After participating in the Dadaist movement as a young man, Evola attached himself to the traditionalist René Guénon, who preached a spiritual doctrine based on his readings of Arab, Buddhist, and Hindu texts. Guénon denounced the materialism of Judeo-Christian ethics as well as the warmongering nationalism of his era, preferring instead a return to nature and a sense of inner oneness. Like Hitlerite mystic Savitri Devi, Evola agreed with Guénon that the world had sunk into a dark age, a Kali Yuga, due to the influence of its Judeo-Christian inheritance and the scientific faith in progress. Evola's spiritual fascism found its first prominent publication in Ur, a syncretic mixture of radical syndicalism, anti-Semitism, anti-clericalism, and the occult. Following his run with Ur, Evola joined Guénon in editing a regular section in Il Regime Fascista, pretty unambiguous there, the periodical of Farinacci, one of the most vicious and ruthless blackshirt leaders and a pioneer of fascist racism in Italy. So we're not exactly looking at a guy who has his hands clean during the fascist regime, right? He's contributing to Il Regime Fascista. As with the occultists of the turn of the 20th century, Evola looked to the misogynist author Otto Weininger for his theory of gender. For Weininger, women did not exist outside of their recognition by men. Women manifested a kind of zero point, symbolized by an empty womb. A society dominated by supermen could only maintain a strong female, could not maintain a strong female identity. Instead, women represented the wilderness, the purity of non-meaning, an inclusiveness and passivity. For all that men embody, nobility, violence, order, and hardness, women became the opposite, namely a soft spiritual vessel that men fill with meaning. It's kind of... Did he get that wrong? That might have been one of the things that the fascists got wrong. For Evola, civilization manifested the social repression of the human spirit and particularly the male individual's achievement of greatness. Greater than mass-based civilization for Evola was culture, which he, as he understood it, could be carefully curated by elites to channel the energy of the masses toward destruction while leaving the higher echelon of spiritual warriors to play in the ashes. Evola declared himself an ardent revolutionary, a counter-revolutionary, an ardent reactionary, a counter-revolutionary, utterly pessimistic about the concept of human progress. The Superman Evola presented was aristocratic and sometimes anarchist. Evola embraced the egoist influence of Stirner, Max Stirner, through the idea of total freedom of the individual aspiring to become an absolute individual who maintains a connection to the entire universe beyond the body. He agreed with Farinacci's critique of Mussolini as overly moderate and looked down on Mussolini's agreements with the Catholic Church, the Lateran Accords. So, according to Evolian racism, and this is the good part, the Aryan race is the apogee of virtues like honor, fidelity, and courage. People of color could ascend to Aryanness only through spiritual and cultural practice. Nothing needed to be resisted more, in Evola's opinion, than the notion that Aryans are equal to non-whites. We go from theoretical domain to the practical one, or to active racism, whenever we take a position before the racial components of a given nation, refusing to acknowledge to all of them the same value, the same dignity, and the same right to impart the tone and form to the whole. So if anybody recognizes that the United States did not keep one single treaty with the native people of this continent, the honor, fidelity, and courage does not jump out to an honest reader of history. At any rate, let's continue. So after the Allied occupation of Rome in 1943, Evola moved to Vienna, Austria to work with the SS, where he imagined that an entire universe of superiority could be delivered out of the thin air of ancient texts and esoteric artifacts. While maintaining a sense of superiority over Mussolini's fascist party, Evola believed that the SS comprised the building blocks of an ideal Ordenstaat, or state of order. Unfortunately for him, the SS work was much blander than he had hoped. Paralyzed from the waist down by a shell while taking a stroll through the Allied bombardment to test his will, Evola returned to Rome disappointed. After the war, however, Evola's call for violence and direct action against NATO would come to paramount influence over the resurgent global fascist movement. So, that's Giulio Evola, one of the spiritual luminaries of fascism, who believed with his whole soul that Hyperborea was just around the corner. And the interesting thing, I think, about Hyperborea is that to this day, there's this myth that not only did Hitler live beyond the Allied defeat of Berlin, but Hitler actually escaped to the Arctic, where he presided over a giant tunnel system created by the Nazis to build UFOs. which at the given hour will deliver humanity from the terrors of parliamentary multiculturalism, and I guess fly people back to the Arctic to enjoy. I mean, I'm perfectly fine with sending all the Nazis to the Arctic. Yeah. Don't get me wrong. But that's silly. Incidentally, it was the number one sort of ideal of Ernst Zundel, who was the main progenitor of Holocaust denial. So if you want to know where to stick Holocaust denial on your bookshelf, it's right next to the chapter on UFOs. You know, right next to the book about the lizard people taking over the. You should probably not have that shelf in your house. Yeah. No, I don't think, I don't see any of those here, yeah. Anyway, so the years have led. The years have led being in Italy, the term for all of the assassinations and bombings that were taking place between 1969, roughly the late 70s, early 80s. And these groups, Alleanza Nazionale, what are some of the other ones? Avanguardia Nazionale, the National Front, which was created in 1967 by a Nazi war guy, what was his name? The Black Prince Borghese. Anyway, so it was not just localized in Italy. The United States actually rescued a number of Nazi war criminals from war tribunals in Germany and either let them escape, like Otto Skorzeny, nicknamed Scarface, who built up an export business in Madrid under Franco, but also Reinhard Gehlen, who was Hitler's spy chief, and who converted the insurgency network that he had built while the Allies were taking over Germany into the backbone of what would become the CIA of Germany, which is the Bundesnachrichtendienst. Thank you, Germany, for making me say that. So, Reinhard Gehlen, basically a Nazi war criminal, created the German CIA, the West German CIA afterwards, and they had been involved in a variety of very sketchy incidents, and their legacy is felt today with the National Socialist Underground, which was a small group of Nazis who were going around killing Turkish people for a number of years in the mid-2000s. So this is what people call the deep state. And it was also connected to the overthrow of the Greek system by the military, which was supported by the United States. to the military coup in Greece. And as a matter of fact, some of these fascist terrorists in Italy went to Greece, took a tour with the military, and came back to Italy and started the strategy of tension. So this is a Europe-wide network of fascist underground, which incidentally, when the fascists would carry out bombings in Italy, they would flee to Spain and then maybe go over to Latin America, where they would participate in the Operation Condor governments that had been facilitated by the CIA to undermine the left and institute shock treatment. Right, the famous Naomi Klein book is very good at discussing this. She only discusses it a little bit, but she goes into the shock therapy of neoliberalism. So does that mean that the United States was a fascist country at the time? No. Does it mean that the United States and a number of other governments throughout the world were fine with using fascists to further their regimes, to undermine the left, and to spread terror throughout their populations? Oh yeah, absolutely. So one of the really fascinating thing that was going on in the late 60s and the 70s is that while this was happening, the fascists recognized that they would have to adapt their ideology. They could no longer be the ideology of collectivism, of absolute authority, of hierarchy, and like national totalitarianism. They had to adapt to what the left was doing, because after 1968 and the great student riots that were happening, the emergence of autonomia in Italy in 1969, they had to actually present themselves as revolutionaries, as national revolutionaries, right? And so many fascists created ties with national liberation states in the global south, like Nasser's Egypt even, and tried to present themselves as the national liberation of Europe, right? So there was actually a group called the European Liberation Front, and it was absolutely a fascist group. Because effectively what they said was, we need a European liberation from multicultural imperialism, which they obviously would connect to Jews, and the great Jewish conspiracy that fascists believe in. And so the idea would be Algeria for the Algerians, France for the French. So there's a liberation movement in Europe where all of the French people can, you know, splinter off into their different ethnicities and, you know, be very proud of themselves for whatever reason. And the immigrants would all repatriate because they would be equally patriotic, you know, and each regime would support the other in a kind of grand fascist internationale, right? So you end up with groups called the Third Way in France, which was a national revolutionary group, or the Struggle of the People in Italy, right? So there's a populist, almost left-wing emergence in fascism that really mimicked its earliest years. And the intellectual auspices there deliberately declared that it was their intention to sort of restart the movement, to spread the cultural underpinnings of what would become the possibility of an authoritarian one-party politics. And that was called the European New Right. The European New Right was absolutely, it's still around, but it was absolutely connected to the strategy of tension and the people who were involved in the Years of Lead. It was absolutely connected as well to the OAS, which was a terrorist group in France that was against Charles de Gaulle and the Fourth Republic and the Fifth Republic, so yeah. Anyway, so the this European New Right asserted the right to difference in this kind of left-wing sort of way. The sense that the equality that puts everybody on the same level is a bad equality, and what we need is the equality of separatism. Okay, so almost like separate but equal, right? Actually, mm-hmm. sort of exactly like separate but equal, enfranchising ethnostates, even within Europe. So, you know, Burgundians in Burgoyne, the, you know, different, you know, ethnicities, Saxons in Saxony, you know, like make sure that the idea of the concept of the modern nation state and its multiculturalism, the sort of idea of everybody interfacing and interacting in the same territory based on general equality and human rights, was anathema. And I always thought this is sort of a trick, right? This is like they're trying to fool us, you know. So like all the like in the United States, what this traverses into is, well, you know, what they say with the pan-secessionism these days is, well, you know, we'll have like a cool anarchist territory here where everybody who wants to be anarchist can come and be anarchist, and then like the Maoists can have their own territory and be Maoists, and like Latinos can have, you know, Azatlan, and they say like black people can like be in Detroit, and the Pacific Northwest could be declared a whites only zone, an ethno state, right? And it's like, yeah, right. You know, you could consolidate your forces and then just take over everybody else, right? This is just colonialism in its germ. And that is the irony of it, because in the 60s and 70s, they started to assert that they were about national liberation, that they were about even about decolonization, right? But fascism is a doctrine that stems directly from imperialism, and it's impossible to believe a fascist when they say that they're against imperialism. So it's, well, okay, yeah. So the European New Right develops as the years of lead are occurring in simultaneously and in relation to the military dictatorships in Latin America and in the United States, authoritarian policies like COINTELPRO, but also the rise of the Patriot movement. So the Patriot, and incidentally, the number one fascist leader of the United States in the 1970s and 1980s is a guy named Willis Carto, who at one point was selling something like 200,000 copies of his newsletter, Spotlight. He, in 1965, brought the leader of the European New Right over to guest edit his publication, with another guy named Roger Pearson, who ended up editing the publication of the Heritage Foundation, mm-hmm. or far-right think tank, and heading up the World Anti-Communist League, which was a very powerful organization of anti-communist groups that had full support of Ronald Reagan. So you see that this underground of fascism has very powerful connections. Although, again, it's a mistake to say with a broad stroke, well, yeah, everybody, these are fascist countries, right? It is a mistake. So what is a fascist country then, right? Just talk a little bit about that and then... So for the United States, I think fascism was described by Lawrence Dennis, who was a fascist. And I think maybe we should take him at his word. He said that it needs to be out elites, people who are coming from the corporate realm but don't really have full power over the country. He says that, very conveniently for him, in fact, that the Constitution has always only served a certain portion of the country. It's only served the interests of the ruling elite. So we'll just do away with it and explicitly put those people in charge. So what you have to do is you do away with the independent judiciary, you even do away with the legislature, and you establish an executive council that presides through an authoritarian leadership over the country and in a semi-populist way. So for Lawrence Dennis, incidentally, again, the mass movement underpinning fascism for Italian fascism, for German fascism, is not really apparent It's a question of really kind of like the takeover of the U.S. government explicitly by a council, an executive council, that rules in the interests of the elites. So, however close to that we might be, you know, if we're not literally absent the judiciary, like we just saw, like the judiciary confronted and halted the ban on immigrants from 7 countries in the Arab world. Was Iran involved in that too?
Yeah.
So not just the Arab world, generally what's called the Middle East, North Africa. So there is still the auspices, there are still the auspices of checks and balances, and when those sort of go away, when those are destroyed, then you really have an authoritarian, sort of totalitarian regime that can be considered fascist. And what I don't like to talk about is proto-fascist movements, because I don't think we can really make that call and say, oh, well, you know, we're steering straight towards fascism, boom, this is proto-fascist or pre-fascist or what have you. I do think that there are proto-fascist conditions of people completely losing faith in a kind of grassroots politics, losing faith in anti-authoritarianism, moving towards elitism and authoritarianism, generally like economic crises, crises of legitimacy that aren't sort of funneled toward mass movements of the left or explicitly anti-fascist politics. So in those conditions, I think that fascism has a chance of emerging, you know, into power, you know, but I don't think anything is determined outright, you know, and similarly, if people want to ask me if Trump is a fascist and so on, I think that is a very interesting question. I've gone back and forth with some people about this more publicly than I should have, but the issue there is in some ways not as important as what we're going to do, because obviously he needs to be opposed on every level, and obviously he's not only benefiting from the rise of fascism, he's facilitating it, as we can see with the FBI these days, which is trying to kick white nationalism out of the terrorist bracket and introduce who knows who in there. So by that same token, if we want, we should analyze Trump's politics. We should recognize his associations, his networks, and we should absolutely not rule out the possibility that as an individual, a guy who had a book of Hitler's speeches in his armoire might have a couple of fascist skeletons in there too, you know? But can we make that call for certain? I don't know. It's a tough one. Can we make the call that the alt-right is fascist? Yeah, absolutely, that is a fascist movement and it has to be opposed physically and ideologically. So. What, you want to, is Q&A or should I just sing Mighty Mouse? I got one part about the punchable Richard Spencer, if y'all want to hear about that. Alright, so, the ethos of egoism and the vision of city-states run like corporations head by monarch CEOs that underwrite much of the dark enlightenment and the neo-reaction are tied to the spatial relationships of Silicon Valley and the nearby communities that tech industry displaces, particularly in the Bay Area. The pattern of gentrification there is an extreme version of a national trend that inflames racial tensions in the United States, although it appears across the Atlantic. Wealthier people adopt hip, edgier fashion, moving into urban enclaves and transforming them into higher class artistic districts while displacing prior working class inhabitants. These groups of hipsters often adopt pro-environmental and protectionist localism. Around 2012, a growing trend among hipsters in Germany was observed, which has appeared also in the United States. Hipsters were seen wearing symbols and slogans, playing with this with these representations of fascism, bringing the aesthetic third positionism of Death in June and other neo-folk groups into the 21st century. These nipsters, Nazi hipsters, defy the traditional image of conservatism with its Christian focus, sexual repression, and roots in industrial capitalism. Instead, they reference Evola's celebration of spiritual exploration and Younger's ideas of the boundless forest of the self and the power of the anarch. The nipster version of returning to one's roots is based on a rejection of consumerism wedded to an updated and more upscale form of Volkish culture. Like the autonomous nationalists, metro hipsters are skilled at manipulating signifiers, skinny jeans, plug piercings, and woodsman beards, happily ensconced in milieus typically associated with the alternative left, like veganism, cafe culture, and bicycle co-ops. It is a kind of boutique fascism that might remind one of Drumont's movement of petit bourgeois, shopkeepers and declassed intellectuals longing for a greater stake in the economy and unwilling to abandon the privileges they enjoy for the sake of social justice, despite their consumer-conscious support of local businesses boasting organic goods from appropriate sources. At the forefront of the new synthesis of fascist theory and style is a white nationalist named Richard Spencer. As a young man, Spencer supported Pat Buchanan and Ross Perot before turning toward the left in graduate school and studying the what he calls the Frankfurt School. When his winding ideological path took him to the right, it was tinged with the left criticism of conventional conservatives. After abandoning his PhD studies for, quote, a life of thought crime, Spencer found himself editing Buchanan's American Conservative, but left after his racist treatment of a rape scandal at Duke University. He then joined the white nationalist Tacky's magazine, founded by American Conservative co-founder Panayotis Tacky Theodorakopoulos. His reputation grew as a popular speaker at the H.L. Mencken Club of Paleoconservatives and Rothbardians. Spencer launched alternativeright.com as a kind of switchboard to connect the radical right positions of paleoconservatism and libertarianism to white nationalism. With the financial help of paleoconservatives at the more mainstream vdare.com, the alt-right movement has come to define and shape the linkages between traditionalism, neo-reaction, pan-secessionism, race realism, esoteric fascism, and the mainstream radical right, despite Spencer's often dismissive, divisive behavior. Spencer has gone on to found the biannual Radix Journal as a sounding board for alt-right ideology, trading in repackaged eugenics theories to rid the world of degenerates and return to a technologically upgraded version of a simpler age. One of his articles, Up With Anarchy, outlines a hypothetical scenario where the Federal Reserve crashes, armies fail, and people split into racial tribalism in which adulteresses and homosexuals would be publicly stoned. Great swathes of land would be fenced off with barbed wire, and bands of thieves, vagrants, and thugs would roam the countryside and godforsaken inner cities, given rise to a new samurai class that, though guided by a code of honor, would apprehend and execute criminals without a pretense of trial. But you know, he calls this scenario fascism without any of the fun qualities. So you can see how it's kind of a... Thanks, Jordan. I got your money at the end of it. He calls this... Jordan's standing in for my mom. He calls this scenario, So you can see how it's kind of gentrified fascism. Like, this is kind of the idea, like, the breakdown of the state would lead to the power of sort of white ethno-tribalism. And he wants to sort of engage in the same themes while promising himself as the guy to do this smoothly, right? So he advances this notion of peaceful ethnic cleansing, you know, which uses the number 11 million undocumented workers need to be deported from the United States, And that exact stuff from the Tantan Network, which I get into a little bit, is a white supremacist, white nationalist, anti-immigration and population control group. They use it as well, or they came up with it, and Trump stole it directly from them. Not only did he steal their numbers, but he also grabbed a couple of their leaders. Chris Kobach, Jeff Sessions, the new Department of Homeland Security head, all veterans of the Tantan Network. So I joked with the SPLC, saying, I wonder when y'all are gonna actually declare Trump's transition team a hate group. And they didn't like my tweet. yeah. I guess it's not that funny. So Trump's definitely on the white nationalist team. He's definitely forwarding their ideas. He's putting their ideas, you know, forward in his platform, including a ban on immigration from the Middle East. And you know, you can watch. I don't recommend you do, but if you ever watch Richard Spencer talk, that's one of his prime positions, is we need a ban on immigrants from these countries. So Trump is actually trying to exercise all of the platform suggestions, or not all of them, but a significant amount of platform suggestions from the National Policy Institute, which is a fascist organization. So, again, is there conjecture that Trump himself is fascist? Yeah. Is the United States a fascist country? Not quite, and we need to stand up and make sure that it doesn't become that, and you know, kick Trump out, and maybe have a revolution. Yeah. All right, so that's the book reading that I'll do. Thank you very much, and if you have any questions, feel free to. Yes. Gamers. Okay, so what I can basically neo-reaction. So there's something called the neo-reaction, which is I think a fascist ideology that draws from Julius Evola. Anytime you see Evola, you're gonna find people who are like, oh no, Evola was not a fascist. He was an elitist. You know, he likes nature. You know, he's a cultist maybe, but you know, he's just a, you know, he's a weird esotericist. But no, the guy is a complete fascist, and people, fascists use Evola to, as a guard, you know, to try, as a mask, because after the war, the anti-fascist courts let him off the hook, because he is a very wealthy. I believe he was a baron. He was like, he was a elite sort of old gentry. And also because they weren't exactly conscientious about their denazification and defascism. So neo-reaction has developed through the tech industry and through this idea of the singularity. And right-wing transhumanism, through which humanity and technology merge into one, and everybody who is sort of against it or not participating becomes a sort of feudal underclass. And you see like reports of tech industry billionaires buying up agricultural land around Silicon Valley, and you know, it starts to get a little bit scary. But so the Silicon Valley reactionary scene is heavily entrenched in right-wing libertarianism, and it's sort of like a lot of these people are the ones producing these video games, and that's why without a doubt the software, you know, the video games that people are putting out, the very popular ones, are absolutely misogynistic. You know, they're actually like spreading misogynistic messaging through the games. And so how do gamers get involved? Well, they're inculcated with misogyny through the games that they're watching, because the developers, a lot of the developers, are involved in the neo-reaction. You know, and it crosses over. Also, there's a big audience for far right-wing science fiction, right? At the Hugo Awards, I talk a little bit about this in the book, the Hugo Awards were almost sort of taken over by this extreme reactionary right-wing movement that called itself there was the sad puppies and then the sick puppies, who wanted to stem the tide of multicultural science fiction writers, you know, of like the multiracial industry, and a lot of that is kind of tied into the growth of Breitbart and the reactionary misogyny of Milo. You know, through Gamergate, which was when female journalists actually reported on the misogyny within the gamer community. They were threatened with rape, they were stalked, you know, all kinds of horrible things happened to them. And and then Milo comes around and he's, you know, supporting the people, the reactionaries, against the women. Right, so that's basically how they become involved. I don't like, you know, tracing everything back to DARPA and all of that stuff, but if you do, I recommend Baudrillard's book America, which is a perfect, pitch-perfect telling of the synthesis between Silicon Valley, which he calls Stalin cool, and the right-wing libertarian ranchers and industry moguls who joined forces for Ronald Reagan and entered the libertarian movement as well. So it's a fascinating thing. Mm-hmm.
Where do you see Pence in this?
Pence! So Mike Pence is a Christian Reconstructionist, isn't he? Christian Reconstructionism is its own crazy thing. That's part of what Richard Spencer was trying to describe in his like Mad Max scenario of adulteresses being stoned, which doesn't sound that bad, right? I think there's a song about that by the Slackers, Married Girl. The idea of like Pence is. I think you could say that his movement is fascist and white nationalist. And the SPLC calls the groups that are involved in his movement white nationalist, to be sure. Focus on the Family is one of them. Rush Dooney is a prominent figure in Christian Reconstructionism, and he's a major power broker in Washington, D.C. So Pence is very much tied into a very deep power center, and as a matter of fact, that's why he was chosen as vice president, because you've got this sort of like decadent presidential candidate on the supposedly family values Republican right. So he needs an anchor, and he goes hard Christian right to keep him steady.
Yeah.
So. That's a really good question, and I don't really go that far into Christian Reconstructionism in this book, because the book is more about how fascism insinuates itself in the left and mainstream right, the Patriot Movement, Alex Jones, and stuff like that. But I think that the book, Gomorrah. Republican Gomorrah by Max Blumenthal. Yeah, that's a very good book to really look into and investigate the Christian Reconstructionist movement. Also, what's his name? Who used to write about Iraq and then became kind of a left wing. Celebrity, not Hitchens.
Hedges.
Chris Hedges. Thank you for reading my mind. He always wears the shirt. So Chris Hedges has a book called Christian Fascism, incidentally, and that's also an interesting one. He talks about Covenant of the Sword and the Arm, and the Northwest Imperative people with Christian identity, although that's sort of different from Christian Reconstructionism. There's an interesting, and Mormonism also. Right. So those are the big three, I think. Mormonism in the Christian right. Mormonism, Christian Reconstructionism, and Christian identity. And incidentally, they were all supported by like Alec and the Koch brothers, libertarian type stuff, and the Wise Use movement, which was explicitly anti-environmentalist, and also at the start of the militia movement, helped give the militia movement its initial push. You know, property rights, the state power over all federal lands, and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. In terms of like putting up a fight against this thing, I mean, how do you feel about the way, you know, the official left is responding to it, which is mainly, you know, the main criticism of Trump is that he's a tool of Russia, and that he's, you know, I mean, it seems like to me to be totally inadequate to what he's actually doing. You know, they're basically criticizing him from the right, as you know. Well, I mean, it depends on, I guess, which side you're talking about.
And who the, I don't know, the question is interesting. I mean, do you consider the official left to be like liberals? Because in that situation, which Fox News loves to do, we're sort of, our backs are against the wall. The official left itself kind of has this like effect where I just want to run around in circles and chase my tail.
Well, I guess there is no official left in the country
anymore.
Not
in the United States.
Right, exactly. But you know, the Democrats, I guess, is what I'm saying.
So I talk a lot about in the book, I talk a lot about Russia and the emergence of National Bolshevism in Russia as a hegemonic movement within the Russian Federation after the fall of the Berlin Wall. I think that Russia is absolutely a key player in the radical right and the fascist movement throughout the world. Okay. And so we ought not to sort of scoff at the prospect of Putin's involvement in, say, the radical right in Europe and the furtherance of the interests of the radical right throughout the world. At the same time, I think that the self-flagellation that often happens on the left of, well, we created Trump, it's our fault, you know, this sort of thing. I think that's also false, and it needs to be addressed. I think that the left needs to have a little bit more confidence and to confront things on our terms.
Yeah, if I could just respond to that a little bit. I mean, don't you think there is a real danger in that the elite in this country wants to go to war with Russia? I mean, there's been a campaign for the last 2 or 3 years since the Ukraine crisis.
My only issue with this discourse, however, is that when you say the elite in the United States, we have a billionaire in office. So who is the elite in the United States? And when you actually look back at Lawrence Dennis, he's talking about the out elite. So we need to actually recognize that there are competing interests in the ruling class, and if we homogenize the ruling class as such, then we really waste a lot of important opportunities.
There's a debate. There's China first, and then Russia second. So
yes.
Yeah.
You mentioned National Bolshevism a second ago.
Yes.
Do you have thoughts on Bannon identifying himself as both a Leninist and a nationalist?
Oh, I have lots of thoughts about Bannon. Not only has he identified himself as sort of a Leninist who seeks to see the whole system crashing down, I take that as sort of just like an ultimatum, just sort of like the point of no return, right? So he's basically saying, I just want to drive the revolution past parliamentarianism and beat everybody else, because that's Lenin's thing. Like, Lenin is just like full on like destroy. At least my readings of Lenin. The other thing about it, though, is that in a speech to the Vatican, he goes, as Alexander Dugin has said, boom, that is interesting. Alexander Dugin being the leading national Bolshevik in the world.
Who said that?
Steve Bannon.
Oh, Steve Bannon
said that? Steve Bannon goes, as Alexander Dugin has said, And so, like, when you say, has said, you know, you already sort of ascribe some sort of, like, prophetic power, right? So, as this person has said, and nobody can contravene, or, you know? And quoting Alexander Dugin in the Vatican as a traditionalist Catholic, you know, that says quite a bit, right? The traditionalism of it is very key here, because what Dugin hopes to do is to, he has this thing called the fourth political theory, where he says that the world has gone through four stages effectively, liberalism, fascism, Marxism, and now the fourth thing, which he of course is like the grandfather of or whatever, the spiritual leader of, but it's really fascism is what he's presenting, which is why he's engaged in all of these fascist groups. But he wants to make sure that traditionalism is not lost in there and that he can sort of bring those traditionalist groups and ideas over to fascism as well. You know, so traditionalist Catholicism is actually becoming one of the most dangerous ideologies in the world. And Jason Wilson, who's outside right now, has done some really remarkable journalism on the subject for The Guardian. So I have a lot of thoughts about Bannon. Mm-hmm.
Can you talk about the new right in France and the current elections?
The European new right in France. So the European new right, one of their things is they try to appear as banal as possible. You know, they'll have the sort of think tanks. That's where the National Policy Institute sort of got its sort of style, except they're a little edgier. But then the thing about the European New Right is that they want to just be perceived as intellectuals who aren't going to harm anybody, you know, with ideas and words. Forget that they were completely integrated with the fascist movement in the during the years of Lead and stuff like that. You know, they're just sort of old, balding men who are bookish and just want to give a few lectures, you know? but through that, they have managed to influence the Front National quite profoundly. And there's a real flow. If you actually look at the individuals involved and the networks, there's a real flow of people from the European New Right to the Front National, from the Front National to the European New Right. Bruno Maigret, Pierre Vial, there's a bunch of people who, although they tried to set up some sort of like distance from fascism, the Front National has definitely been affected by the creep. And they are the forerunners, right, of the current elections. Le Pen, Marine Le Pen, is leading currently in the polls. So it's quite a disaster, and it's frightening as well, because the competitor, Fillon, is actually far right as well. He represents traditional Catholicism and this sort of reactionary tradition that has always been antithetical and aggressively against the parliamentary tradition of the republican structure in France since the revolution. I don't want to present myself as a sort of the spokesperson for liberal parliamentary democracy and things like that. I obviously believe that there are different and better systems. However, the reaction and the counter-revolution is a real disaster. And he's a free market sort of right-winger. So on the one hand, and this is the reason why, he's a free market a guy who also has financial scandals up to his eyeballs. So you either trust that guy to cut everybody's pensions and throw the whole society, you know, into neoliberal shock treatment, or you trust the Front National, which is going to expel all the immigrants and all the non-white French, further the interests of a sort of fascist ethno-state, while keeping the social wage, you know, or you know, as which they sort of promise people they'll do, which undoubtedly they won't, because they're politicians. So the French are saying Front National because we'll keep our social wage. However, the only thing about that is it looks like the center candidate, Macron, who represents a sort of against the status quo, but also the liberal system, it appears as gaining ground. It appears he might beat Fillon. So the end runoff will be between Macron and Le Pen. And in that case, there will be a cordon sanitaire that will cut off the Front National, and everybody will just tactically vote for Macron. And so you'll end up with a corrupt liberal austerity regime again, which is, I mean, is better on the left, because the left can then have something to struggle against and push toward a better system. Right?
Yeah.
As opposed to a para-fascist regime or a radical right regime that will just be... Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You don't consider the Front National a fascist party?
I think that there are enough connections to raise that question for sure. Unfortunately, there are a lot of academics who want to laugh at that kind of idea, that prospect. In fact, the Front National was created by fascists in league with traditional Catholics. So the thing about the Front National is that I think they're somewhere maybe between the radical right and para-fascism. Kind of like Francisco Franco after World War II, because after World War II it was very embarrassing to associate yourself publicly as a regime with fascism, because fascism had just been destroyed, supposedly. So Franco kicked out a lot of the phalangists, the fascists in his cabinet, and introduced more of the Carlists and Legitimists and religious right wing. And so that kind of thing, which has been called the Popular Front of the Right in a recent interesting piece, but is also known as the National Front, quite frankly. That's basically what it is, yeah. You could call it a Popular Front of the Right, but it's a National Front. And I think that there's certainly a case to be made, like for Trump, that these are in fact sort of crypto-fascist or essentially fascist groups underneath the sort of onion peels of concessions to parliamentary democracy. So unless they're upfront saying, we want an ethno-state, you know, at this point, it's difficult to say academically that this is a fascist group. But when you read between the lines, the question really hangs in the air. Absolutely. Look at the tricolor flame. Their logo they stole from the Italian social movement. They stole their logo from a fascist group and openly said, we want to get out of the fascist ghetto, that's a quote, and create a populist party. Yeah. So, and that's part of the reason why I wrote this book, is that I think it's absurd that parties like this are given a sort of pass into mainstream discourse as radical right. I think that is that we have to, through network analysis, assess these parties as what they are, which is tending toward a fascist state. Although they don't upfront say that, and there might be some checks and balances along the way, and we can stop them, you know, at the heart of their interest is fascism. And it always has been. It's easier to say with Golden Dawn, for example. Golden Dawn is so clearly fascist that you're just like, even academics with the strictest sort of metrics will say, yeah, Golden Dawn is fascist. But then you look at the parliamentary groups, you look at the different coalitions. Well, the Front National is right in the mix, right? So the Svoboda in Ukraine. Svoboda in Ukraine used to be called the Social National Party. They were Nazis. They are Nazis. And they visited with Le Pen, and they changed their name to Svoboda, which means freedom, but it was supposed to be taken from the Austrian Freedom Party, right? Which was run at that time by Jörg Haider. He's an impolite subject, to say the least. Jörg Haider. He's a real treat. I write about him a little bit, so. Anyway, so that's the thing, is that, and also the five-point movement, right? The five-star movement in Italy. People want to associate Five Star with the left, but if you look at the parliamentary group they're in, a parliamentary group with the Sweden Democrats. Sweden Democrats were created a short time ago by Nazis. So what do you say? What do you say when a supposedly left populist group joins in league with a bunch of Nazis? I don't know. You know? I think that it's time to sort of to evolve the existing analysis, which creates ideal types between radical right and fascism, and that each party ought to be analyzed as a hybrid in itself. And there's a scale, right? And so again, it's about the conditions even more than it's about the parties themselves. Because Hitler's party presented itself as a parliamentarian party. Mussolini's party presented itself as a party willing to work within parliament, right? So, you know, what if the Front National presents themselves as a party that wants to work within the parliament, you know? That doesn't say what they're gonna do 5 years down the line, you know? So yeah, we absolutely have to analyze the history of these parties and these groups and understand that there are tendencies, right? These tendencies are leading towards certain goals, and they should all be shut down. Which I respect the French idea of the cordon sanitaire. The French idea of the cordon sanitaire is that we have the mainstream right wing and we have the mainstream left wing, the socialists, and there's a knockout round, and if the Front National enters the knockout round with one of the other parties, we're going to put our differences aside and not vote for the Front National.
You can only do that so long, I think. That's the thing.
We'll see.
at some point, the appeal of either fascism or the real left is going to be too strong.
That's why everybody's looking to France right now, and we really need to stop this sort of neoliberal capitulation to austerity. You know, that's really what's feeding into fascism right now, is the depletion of the social wage, the increase of despair. Nobody believes in anything. You know, it's like it's important to have faith in a better system, and not to use immigrants as a bargaining chip in having a greater livelihood. That was an interesting statement. I had another thing that I wanted to.
Sorry, I didn't mean to.
Yeah, no. I wanted to build on what you said, but it slipped my mind.
Okay.
I had a lot of coffee, so that's why I'm yelling at y'all. Remind myself of a right wing populist right now. And you there!
Yeah, I mean, I think there's like a saying I've heard that either, you know, when real socialism fails, national socialism wins. And I kind of feel like that's the situation we're in now.
There's an interesting sort of statement in the 20s that fascism is the product of every failed revolution.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned it before with the 1918, you know, Rosa Luxemburg.
And then Occupy, that's the fear, right? Yeah. That Occupy was the failed revolution.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I don't think that things are that short term. I think there's still a big chance to overthrow the regime of Trump and establish people power in the United States and uproot the current era of reaction that's spread across the world. I don't think it's by any means determined, and I don't think it's set in stone.
It's very early. I mean, I guess, you know, what I'm trying to get at is it depends on how we do it and who we rely on to do it, you know, and relying on the Democrats.
No, you got to rely on ourselves.
Corporate Democrats to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So, you know, yeah. Anyway, I don't mean this to be a one-sided conversation.
Yeah, yeah.
So, sorry.
All right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The reason I asked about Pence is because if we overthrow the Trump administration, meaning basically getting rid of Trump, we still have Pence.
We also still have all the Democrats.
Right.
So yeah, no, I don't. Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
An overthrow is not a simple thing. It's not a matter of getting rid of this guy, the clown in front.
No, yeah, I think It's been called a social revolution. I think social movements have developed and evolved for a long time, and Kevin Van Meter, standing right there, has written in depth about modern social movements. He's doing great work at PSU. There is a lot of investigation into how social movements can actually take power and establish power sharing, and discard the current model and move toward ecological sustainability, co-ops, power sharing, you know, models that we haven't even come up with yet. I mean, a lot of things just arise out of exigency and people's self-organization. So I think that that's what we really need to trust. What do y'all think?
Get busy.
Other questions? Thank you all so much for coming. I hope you like the book. If you decide to get it, remember that some of the proceeds go to anti-fascist work, organizing, and feminist work. So yeah, thank you all for coming, and you've been really awesome. If you want to grab me?